brings the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty, so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I will be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. So worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. All that you've done for me. When the music fades and all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth, that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song. For a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within. Through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. King of endless worth, no one could express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, all I have is yours, every single breath. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within. Through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. Towers over me. Gracious tempest in the sea, your love is like a storm. Oh, let your tide of mercy ring. Let it flood my heart again. Surround me like an ocean. Your love is crashing over me, is surging like a raging sea. Immerse me in the wonder of your love. A downpour of unending grace, consuming all my reckless ways. My sin submerged, your love has saved my soul. Your love is like a storm. Gracious tempest in the sea.
raging like a raging sea. Immerse me in the wonder of your love. A downpour of unending grace, consuming all my reckless ways. My sin submerged, your love has saved my soul. Your love is like a storm. Oh. Your love is crashing over me. It's surging like a raging sea. Immerse me in the wonder of your love. A downpour of unending grace, consuming all my reckless ways. My sins submerged, your love has saved my soul. Your love is like a storm. 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 Your love is crashing over me. It's surging like a raging sea. Immerse me in the wonder of your love. A downpour of unending grace, consuming all my reckless ways. My sins submerged, your love has saved my soul. Your love is like a storm. Oh, your love.
You are good, you are good, when there's nothing good in me. You are love, on display for all to see. You are light, and darkness closes in. You are hope, you have covered all my sin. Yeah. You are peace, when my fear is crippling. You are true, even in my wandering. You are joy, you're the reason that I sing. You are life, in you death has lost its sting.
Sing, oh, I'm running to your arms.
And oh, I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world, forever reign. You are more than my words will ever say. You are Lord, all creation will proclaim. You are here, in your presence I'm made whole. You are God, of all else I'm letting go. And oh, I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world, forever reign. I'm running to your arms,
I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world, forever reign. My heart will sing, no other name. Jesus, Jesus. My heart will sing, no other name. Jesus, Jesus. My heart will sing, no other name. Sing it out. Jesus, Jesus. My heart will sing, no other name. Jesus, Jesus. And oh, I'm running to your arms. I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world, forever reign. I'm running to your arms. I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world, forever reign. My heart will sing, no other name. Jesus, Jesus. My heart will sing, no other name. Jesus, Jesus. Let's all stand for this last song. Nothing worth more that will ever come close. No thing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves. When my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord.
There's nothing worth more that would ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord.
Father, that is indeed what we desire, your presence among us. Father, please just give us a deeper awareness of that, a deeper awareness of your presence, to know your goodness, to taste your goodness. You are amazing, and we love you, Lord. As we open your word together, Father, we desire just to hear from you this evening through your word. We desire that that happens across the campus, every place that your word is being shared and taught, Lord, that you would indeed make your presence known. Reveal yourself to us in a deeper way. We love you, Lord, and we praise you in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. You may be seated. And if there are any high schoolers, junior hires, middle schoolers that want to go up to the teen room, you're welcome to do that. You're also welcome here. How are you guys all doing? Really? Awesome. That's good to hear. This really wasn't part of the message, but I as we were worshiping together, it felt like it was necessary to say that, because we're in challenging times. There is so much stress from so many different directions in our lives. I mean, we live in a stressful world anyway. I've been reading this book that's actually, it's called The Overload Syndrome. I'm reading it for a class. And it's kind of funny because I think the copyright is 1998, and it's talking about how overwhelmed we are with technology and information and all these things, and it's 22 or 3 years old. It's amazing. So as you're reading it, you're saying, I mean, the big difference is that they need to replace pagers with cell phones, right? I mean, it's talking about pagers and older technology. And Pastor Matt this morning or this afternoon in the class that I'm reading that book for was talking about how fast things are doubling. And I don't remember all the numbers exactly, but it's like written words are doubling every 8 years. And electronic information or data is doubling every 4 years. And just like general stuff that's out there, like your pictures of your last vacation and all this data that's being accumulated, all that kind of information is doubling every 2 years. And actually, those statistics are also 20 years old. So you can imagine what it's like today. And just the overwhelmingness of all this new information coming at us. And we're expected to learn new things all the time. We're expected to keep up with Windows or iOS software things, expected to keep up with Office or whatever kind of programs you might use at work. And it's nearly impossible. No one person certainly can keep up with all of the new information and all the new things that are happening. And again, this really wasn't part of the message, but all that to say, because of the pressure, and then just the crazy things going on in our world right now, right, with the pandemic and really disunity in our country and disunity in the world about how to deal with things, it's stressful. So I think the word that I had from the Lord while we were worshiping is if you find yourself in a place where that stress is becoming depression, talk to somebody. Call the church office, talk to one of the pastors, call up your best friend, speak to someone who can speak truth into your life. I don't even know where the verse is, but it talks about when things that are in the darkness come into the light, good things happen, right? That's a really loose paraphrase of the verse, and it's really talking about sin, not just stress and things. But when things are brought into the light, when we talk about them with and to each other, it lightens our load. Every time I do a memorial service, I use this old proverb that I can't remember who it's attributed to, but multiple cultures actually it's been attributed to over the years, and it's a joy shared is doubled, and a grief shared is halved. So same kind of concept. When we talk about things with each other, it lightens our load. And you know, it's easy to relate it to Bible verses. The Lord says, share your burdens with one another. Help each other. Help each other carry those burdens. So I just want a word of encouragement. If you find yourself in that place where the stresses and the various things are leading to a point of depression, like you can't get out of bed, you have no will to do things, talk to somebody. And even if you're not at that point yet, but you're feeling the stress, again, it's just good to talk to your friends, talk to a pastor. Because again, grief or stress that's shared is halved. We help carry one another's burdens. So the message really tonight, we've been going through, we actually started in Genesis, I don't know how long ago, and we've made it up to 1 Kings at this point. We'll be in chapter 16 tonight. We'll actually be at the end of chapter 15, just a few verses that we didn't catch last week. And then all the way through chapter 16, if you have the chart of the kings that we've handed out a few times, there weren't any left over and set over there tonight, but essentially, if you look at the right-hand, well, if you look at the left-hand side, four people down, four kings down, Jehoshaphat is where we left off at the end of the last verses that we did in chapter 15 last week, and he's not going to be in the story at all tonight. It actually, in Chronicles, where we stopped in Chronicles last week also, because we used some parallel passages, it picks up in the Jehoshaphat story there in Chronicles, right after Asa and Baasha and the other kings that we were learning about in Chronicles last week. This week, in Kings, it actually shifts to the north. So everything shifts to the right-hand side of that chart, Kings of Israel. And we're going to start with Nadab, and it goes all the way down to Ahab. Covers about 50-some years in one chapter here. So very rapid, very quickly through this time span of 50 years. If you think about just how, again, this is kind of a rapid succession, and you know, when we went through Samuel, we were basically three generations all the way through 1 and 2 Samuel. Even the first part of Kings, the first 11, 12 verses was all about Solomon. So it was a time span of his 40-year reign. And now we're speeding up. At the end of the chapter tonight, it's actually going to slow back down with Ahab. You guys probably all recognize Ahab. Ahab is married to Jezebel, which will probably ring a bell. And that's when we get into Elijah and Elisha, the stories of the prophets. So it gets, not that tonight's not exciting, but it gets much more exciting, I think, when we get into the Elijah stories in particular with the prophets and the interactions with the kings. So we're not going to reference this any further tonight, but you can just see that we're jumping through about a third of the kings of Israel tonight, or rolling through them. And it's interesting because some of these kings, and we'll talk about this as we're going through, but some of these kings were actually quite famous in the world. But they get very little airtime in Kings, and very little airtime in Chronicles, for that matter, if any at all in Chronicles. And the reason for that is because the book of Kings is concerned with, it's a theological history. It's not necessarily concerned about chronology or all the events that happened. It does mention a few events that happened in the reigns of these kings. But it's more concerned with, you remember the two things that it's concerned with, how they compare to King David, and how well they followed the Deuteronomic law. And we're going to look back at those, because I've referenced it multiple times, so we're going to look back at a couple of passages in Deuteronomy. So if you've got your finger in 1 Kings 16, I'm going to assume, you also want to find Deuteronomy 17 and Deuteronomy 30. So it's going to be back about five or six books to the left in your Old Testament. And what this is going to give us, or what it's going to tell us here, is basically what the character of the kings is supposed to be. In fact, there's probably, quite likely, a heading in your Bible that says the law of the kings in this little section. And I mentioned it's been quite a while since we went through the book of Deuteronomy, but when we went through it, I know I said it was one of, if not the most important books in the entire Bible, actually. It's absolutely the most important book in the Old Testament, and quite likely it's certainly one of the most important books in all of the Bible. And the reason is because it lays out God's character. It lays out all of the rules that Israel is supposed to follow as a nation, as a theocracy, a nation living under God, a nation living under God, but not in the same way that our Pledge of Allegiance says we're one nation under God. We are not a theocracy. We do not have this covenant relationship with God that Israel had or has. So Deuteronomy basically is their constitution. This is how they're supposed to run their government. This is how they're supposed to run their nation. And the two things that these two passages that we're going to look at are what the prophets are always calling people back to. It's what they're drawing people back to. It's like, if you would only live this way, then God would bless you. If you would be obedient and follow the Lord, he would bless you. In many ways, the New Testament tells us the same things, does it not? We'll talk about that a little bit more so that you don't think I'm a legalist later. But in many ways, it certainly calls us to obedience and gives us one key point of obedience that we'll talk about as we wrap up. So Deuteronomy 17, verse 14 is where it says, "Laws concerning Israel's kings. When you come to the land that the Lord your God is giving you, and you possess it and dwell in it, and then say, 'I will set a king over me, like all the nations that are around me.'" This should sound familiar if you were here when we were going through Samuel, and then they were saying, "We want a king like all the other nations." Verse 15, God says, "You may indeed set a king over you, whom the Lord your God will choose. One from among your brothers you shall set as king over you. You may not put a foreigner over you who is not your brother. Only he must not acquire many horses for himself or cause the people to return to Egypt in order to acquire many horses. Since the Lord has said to you, 'You shall never return that way again,' and he shall not acquire many wives for himself, lest his heart turn away." Remember, this is exactly what happened to Solomon. His heart was turned away by his many wives. And they were foreign wives, was the other part of this. "Nor shall he acquire for himself excessive gold and silver. And when he sits on the throne of his kingdom, he shall write for himself in a book a copy of this law, approved by the Levitical priests. And it shall be with him, and he shall read it all the days of his life, that he may learn to fear the Lord his God by keeping all the words of this law and these statutes and doing them, that his heart may not be lifted up above his brothers, and that he may not turn aside from the commandment, either to the right hand or to the left, so that he may continue long in his kingdom, he and his children in Israel." The laws concerning Israel's kings. This is how they were supposed to act and the character that they were supposed to have. The other place that I want you to look is Deuteronomy 30. Starting in verse 15. You might notice just a little before, actually verse 11, and the heading in my Bible anyway, says the choice of life and death. This is the choice of obedience or disobedience and the results thereof. So verse 15, this is, you could almost consider this laws concerning the citizens of Israel, laws concerning the citizens of the kingdom. Verse 15, "See, I set before you today life and good, death and evil. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I command you today, by loving the Lord your God, by walking in his ways, and by keeping his commandments and his statutes and his rules, then you shall live and multiply, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to take possession of it. But if your heart turns away, and you will not hear, but are drawn away to worship other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall surely perish. You shall not live long in the land that you are going over the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today, that I have set before you life and death, blessing and curse. Therefore, choose life, that you and your offspring may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying his voice, and holding fast to him. For he is your life and length of days, that you may dwell in the land that the Lord swore to your fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, to give them." Essentially, you remember, God has promised this land to Abraham, and Joshua is the one who's come in and taken possession of it, or about to. This actually is Moses speaking to the people and telling them, obey God and things will go well with you. Disobey and you won't be long in the land. couple of issues there. One, he says you won't live long in the land. That could easily mean that you're not going to have a long life. You're going to perish, he says, which we're all going to perish, right, because of sin. So it's not necessarily some immediate thing that he's talking about, but that you're not going to live long in the land also can be that I'll take the land away from you, or I'll take you away from the land, actually. Still their land, still their possession, but as we know, later on in Kings, the people actually are removed from the land. They're taken into captivity. 522 or 722 BC, the northern tribes all get taken into Assyria, or taken over by Assyria and dispersed. And in 586, the Babylonians come and take Judah and take them all back to Babylon. So this is exactly what happens. And these are the two places that the prophets are always pointing back to. And this is when it says King so-and-so and the formulaic laying out of how well the kings did. When we're reading those tonight in Kings, this is exactly what he was referring back to, that they didn't uphold this. They didn't live out these commandments. They didn't live like David, because David actually was a pretty good example of the kind of king he's talking about here. And the kingdom under David and under Solomon in the beginning lived up to these requirements fairly well. So we can go back to 1 Kings now. And we'll start in 15, verse 24. Now we read this last week, just this one verse, but we didn't read anything from 25 on. So, and Asa, who we read about last week, and all the things that he had done, he slept with his fathers and was buried with his fathers in the city of David, his father. And Jehoshaphat, his son, reigned in his place. If you remember, Asa was actually a pretty good king. He has a good burial here. He's honored and buried with David, his father, who again is not his direct father, but Asa is a direct descendant of David. And then Jehoshaphat, his son, reigns in his place. Again, we're not going to see anything else about Jehoshaphat tonight. In fact, he doesn't show back up in 1 Kings until it's like chapter 20, I think, or 22. Verse 25. So now at this point, the focus is shifting to the north, as I said earlier. And Nadab is going to be the first king here. Both of the first kings, Rehoboam and Jeroboam, have both passed at this point. And Nadab, Jeroboam's son, takes over. Verse 25. Nadab, the son of Jeroboam, began to reign over Israel in the second year of Asa, king of Judah. And he reigned over Israel 2 years. He did what was evil in the sight of the Lord and walked in the way of his father and in his sin, which he made Israel to sin. Two things here. One, don't get confused by the fact that Asa just died, and now it says in the second year of Asa. We've actually backed up in time. He's just using southern kings as a reference point for the northern kings, and he does the same thing when he introduces southern kings. He uses the northern king's reign as a reference point, and that's how people make nice charts like this that we can follow and see where the reigns coincide. Other thing, it's interesting, it says that he walked in the way of his father, so basically he did exactly what Jeroboam did, which was the Jeroboam cult. Remember, he set up a place in Bethel in the south and Dan in the north with a golden calf and the Jeroboam cult. And he called it Yahweh worship because they talked about priests and all these things, just like what the south had. In fact, much of what we're going to see in the north tonight is counterfeit Yahweh worship. We even to the point of having a counterfeit temple when we end up with Ahab at the end of chapter 16. And take note that it also said he not only did he walk in the ways of his father and in his sin, but he also made Israel sin. So I think I said it last week, but keep in mind that you can influence people, and if we're not telling people true things, real things about God, we can lead them to sin or lead them to bad things. And in our culture, that's oftentimes not that big of a deal. There's all kinds of voices in our culture talking about, well, Jesus is this, or Jesus is that, or Jesus was a nice guy, but he wasn't really God. He was a wise man, he was a prophet, all these things. Well, these are false notions of who Jesus is. Jesus was God and man in the flesh, in one body, come to take away the sins of the world. And that's the truth. That's the gospel message that needs to be shared, not the fuzzy-feely Jesus that some people talk about. Here, it's okay. And because in the founding of our documents, as Pastor Rick has said multiple times, in fact, he talks about it when he taught through this passage, well, not this point exactly, but when I said one nation under God, just try and replace one nation, just try and say it like this, one nation under Jesus. Our founding fathers would have never gone for that, and neither would anybody in our, well, very few people in our government today would go for that either. For good reason, in many ways, they didn't want to have the same kind of heavy-fisted, you had to be a part of the Church of England, right? When our founding fathers came from England, that was the rub. You had to be part of the Church of England. Before that, you had to be part of the Roman Catholic Church, you know, out of Rome, out of Italy. They didn't want this kind of heavy-handedness. They wanted to be able to worship in the ways that they wanted to, which is great as long as they're worshiping the way the Bible calls us to worship. The other part of that is it's perfectly fine in our culture. Somebody in class today was talking about it. That's your truth. You can talk about God that way. That's your truth. That's great. I'm glad that works well for you. That's actually illegal in heaven. It may be illegal here to talk about God any way people desire, but it's illegal in heaven. People will be judged for that. We'll be judged for that. Which is why not many should desire to teach, I think James says, because you'll be held to a higher standard. Thank you. Thank you very much. This is true. It is a fearful thing. Sometimes some of the things that come out of my mouth once in a while, it's like, I wish I could take that back. But once it's out, it's too late. So, okay, we haven't gotten very far here. Verse 27, Baasha, the son of Ahiah. The other cool thing about teaching in multiple weeks here is I actually get to correct some of my pronunciations. Ahiah, they're both probably work, but Ahiah, I think, is probably the more proper pronunciation here. So Baasha, the son of Ahiah of the house of Issachar, conspired against him. And Baasha struck him down at Gibbethon, which belonged to the Philistines. This is a place where there had been a lot of, in fact, it happens over a pretty long span of time here where they're trying to take this town back from the Philistines. So apparently it changed hands multiple times. For Nadab and all Israel were laying siege to Gibbethon. So Baasha killed him in the third year of Asa, king of Judah, and reigned in his place. And as soon as he was king, he killed all the house of Jeroboam. He left to the house of Jeroboam not one that breathed until he had destroyed it, according to the word of the Lord that he spoke by his servant Ahiah the Shilonite. You remember the prophecy against Jeroboam? He said, those who die in the city are going to be eaten by the dogs, and those who die out in the fields are going to be eaten by the birds. And he told Jeroboam, because you have done this evil thing, you've set up this false worship in the north, that you'll be judged for it, and you'll lose the kingdom, and your family will be cut off, right? So here we're reading about Baasha, who is the guy who's carrying out this judgment from God. But I don't want you to confuse that with the idea that God told Baasha to go do this, because he didn't. In fact, he judges Baasha for going and doing this. God oftentimes uses, in fact, he used Assyria, an evil nation, to judge Israel. He oftentimes uses evil to judge evil, which is a good thing. There's plenty of evil going around, so he doesn't need to use righteous people to judge evil people. Although, I also think that Baasha had an opportunity. If his heart would have been right, if his motives would have been right, I think there's potential that he could have been carrying out God's judgment without incurring the wrath that he ends up incurring upon himself. But we'll talk about that a little bit at the end. So as soon as he's king, he wipes out all the house. And verse 30, it was for the sins of Jeroboam that he sinned and that he made Israel to sin. Again, Jeroboam drew Israel into this sin, and because of the anger to which he provoked the Lord, the God of Israel. That statement is going to happen multiple times through here, the anger which God was provoked to because of the kind of worship that they were doing, because it wasn't the kind of worship that he told them was okay. So God does care very much about how we worship him, about how we interact and relate to him. Verse 31, now the rest of the acts of Nadab and all that he did, are they not written in the book of the Chronicles of the kings of Israel? And there was war between Asa and Baasha, king of Israel, all their days. Verse 33, in the third year of Asa, king of Judah, Baasha, the son of Ahijah, began to reign over all Israel at Tirzah. This was the capital at that time in the north. And he reigned 24 years. So he has a fairly long reign, which you think might mean that he was blessed of the Lord, but this is not the case. As it tells us in verse 34, he did what was evil in the sight of the Lord, and he walked in the way of Jeroboam, and in his sin, which he made Israel to sin. So just like the king before him, and just like the king before him, and just like Jeroboam who started it all, they're all walking the same path. Chapter 16, and the word of the Lord came to Jehu, the son of Hanani, against Baasha, saying, since I exalted you out of the dust and made you leader over my people Israel, and you have walked in the way of Jeroboam and have made my people Israel to sin, provoking me to anger with their sins, behold, I will utterly sweep away Baasha and his house, and I will make your house like the house of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat. Anyone belonging to Baasha who dies in the city, the dog shall eat, and anyone of his who dies in the field, the birds of the heavens shall eat. Exact same judgment and curse that the Lord put on Jeroboam. Which, again, it kind of might ask us why. Didn't he just carry out God's plans? Well, on one hand, he did. Verse 5. Now the rest of the acts of Baasha and what he did and his might, he was not a weak king, are they not written in the books of the Chronicles of the kings of Israel? And Baasha slept with his fathers and was buried at Tirzah. And Elah, his son, reigned in his place. Moreover, the word of the Lord came to the prophet Jehu, the son of Hanani, against Baasha and his house, both because of all the evil that he did in the sight of the Lord, provoking him to anger with the work of his hands in being like the house of Jeroboam, so continuing Jeroboam's sin, doing the same things. And then this last line, and also because he destroyed it. So God's judging him here. He's bringing the same judgment upon Baasha because he destroyed the house of Jeroboam. And I'll submit to you now, and we'll talk about it later, that this is because of the motivations of his heart, why he did what he did. Verse 8, in the 26th year of Asa, king of Judah, Elah, the son of Baasha, began to reign over Israel in Tirzah, and he reigned 2 years. But his servant Zimri, commander of half his chariots, conspired against him when he was at Tirzah. Drinking himself drunk in the house of Azra, who was over the house of Tirzah, Zimri came in and struck him down and killed him in the 27th year of Asa, king of Judah, and reigned in his place. So Elah is Baasha's son. He reigns for 2 years, and Zimri, who's not like his main commander, but a sub-commander over half of his chariots, just like it says, conspires against him. So he wasn't in this alone. There were some other people that knew about this and were helping him. Probably Azra here was one of those, and we're going to find out here in just a few minutes that he probably thinks he's doing Israel, the kingdom of Israel, the northern kingdom, a favor, because most of the army is actually out once again, or maybe still, back at the town that we just talked about. Anyway, back in the same place where they were chapter 15. Still fighting with the Philistines, or perhaps fighting with them again. And the king is back in the palace getting quite intoxicated. I was trying to think of a good, nothing worthy of saying in church was coming to mind about how drunk he was. I apologize for what was going through my head, but just snockered. So, and I'm sure he was being fed alcohol by his host there because he's part of, very likely part of this conspiracy that Zimri has going on. So he conspires against him, he kills him, and he takes over as king immediately. And we're going to find out Zimri is really famous. You guys have all heard of him, right? He had a super long reign, 7 whole days. So he's very famous for being the shortest king on record in Israel, 7 days, which is probably why you haven't heard of him unless you've read this chapter recently. Where was I at? 15? Oh, no, back a little ways. 11, thank you. When he began to reign, as soon as he had seated himself on his throne, he struck down all the house of Baasha. He did not leave him a single male of his relatives or his friends. Take note here that, as I said, he reigns for 7 days. We're going to find out here in just a little bit. But in that 7 reign period, he manages, so quite the conspiracy going on here apparently, he manages to wipe out all of the male relatives and friends. And what this probably is referring to is not just those who were in the kingly line who would have taken over after Elah, but anybody who would have been a blood avenger, anybody who would have come with retribution in mind after Zimri. So very short span of time, but accomplishes a lot. And again, probably thinks he's doing Israel as a nation a favor. They don't seem to think that so much, as we're soon to find out. So thus Zimri destroyed all the house of Baasha, according to the word of the Lord, which he spoke against Baasha by Yehu the prophet, for all the sins of Baasha and the sins of Elah his son, which they sinned, and which they made Israel to sin, provoking the Lord God of Israel to anger with their idols. Now the rest of the acts of Elah and all that he did, are they not written in the books of the Chronicles of the kings of Israel? Verse 15, in the 27th year of Asa, king of Judah, Zimri reigned 7 days in Tirzah. Now the troops were encamped against Gibbethon, this is the town I was talking about, which belonged to the Philistines. And the troops who were encamped heard it. They said, Zimri has conspired and he has killed the king. Therefore, all Israel made Omri the commander of the army, king over Israel that day in the camp. So Omri went up from Gibbethon and all Israel with him, and they besieged Tirzah. And when Zimri saw that the city was taken, he went into the citadel of the king's house and burned the king's house over him with fire and died because of his sins that he committed, doing evil in the sight of the Lord, walking in the way of Jeroboam, and for his sin which he committed, making Israel to sin. Now the rest of the acts of Zimri, which must have been voluminous in 7 days, and the conspiracy that he made, are they not written in the book of the Chronicles of the kings of Israel? So here's the picture. We've got Omri, who's up with the army at Gibbethon, besieging it against the Philistines, and Zimri is actually one of his cohorts. He's not equal, but Omri would have been his commander. So the army just says, hey, we're going to make Omri king. We don't know what Zimri's up to or why he's done this, but we'd like Omri, so we're going to make him king. They go down, besiege. I mean, they leave what they were doing with the Philistines there, go back to Tirzah, besiege it, and Zimri can see that it's, I mean, there's no hope. So he commits suicide. Picture this, okay. I said there were some parallels between just some counterfeit things going on, okay? Who's the last king we can think of that committed suicide? Who fell on his sword? Saul, after he was injured? Yeah. So one of the parallels is starting here. There's just this parallel thing going on and these counterfeit kings happening and counterfeit, just all kinds of counterfeit ideas and thoughts and temples happening in the north. Which is just like the enemy, isn't it? To produce counterfeit things, counterfeit religion. Verse 21. Then the people of Israel were divided into two parts. Half of the people followed Tibni, the son of Ginath, to make him king, and half followed Omri. So there's some division in the camp. Not everybody's behind Omri after this happens, and you're going to see some dating that's going to happen here in just a few minutes. Keep in mind, or I'll just explain it before we get there, but the first part of it, the first 4 years, there's actually this co-reign going on between Omri and Tibni. And so that's part of the total 12 years that it's going to tell us that Omri reigns. And when it talks about him reigning from Tirzah for 6 years, four of that is co-reigning, or there's this division. He doesn't have total control over the north. These two guys, there's this battle going on, and it doesn't say that they physically fought. They may have. It seems to kind of indicate that Tibni probably died of natural causes, but don't know for sure. Anyway, it's 4 years into this initial reign of Omri and Tibni when Omri takes over, and then for another 8 years, he's the ruler, making 12 total, okay? And that's just important to kind of keep in your head, because as it talks about some numbers here, if you don't know that, it doesn't make sense. So the people are divided, half following Tibni, half following Omri, verse 22, but the people who followed Omri overcame the people who followed Tibni, the son of Ginath. So Tibni died, and Omri became king. Now, there may have been a battle here, but just as easily this, they overcame them. They outlasted them. They were more powerful. They had more influence, and they just were they were the victors without swords being drawn, potentially. Verse 23, in the 31st year of Asa, king of Judah, Omri began to reign over Israel, and he reigned for 12 years. 6 years he reigned in Tirzah. He bought the hills of Samaria from Shamar for 2 talents of silver, and he fortified the hill and called the name of the city that he built Samaria, after the name of Shamar, the owner of the hill. Omri did what was evil in the sight of the Lord. And catch this, and did more evil than all who were before him. For he walked in all the way of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, and in the sins that he made Israel to sin, provoking the Lord, the God of Israel, to anger by their idols. Now the rest of the acts of Omri that he did, and the might that he showed, are they not written in the book of the Chronicles of the kings of Israel? And Omri slept with his fathers and was buried in Samaria, and Ahab, his son, reigned in his place. We're going to read about Ahab here in just a moment as we finish off the chapter, but it's important to understand, I said earlier that Kings, the idea, the historiographical story that it's trying to portray is about theology, not all the events of these guys' lives. Many of the kings, it gives us one event that happened. Omri was actually very famous. The land in the north, the Assyrians called it the land of Omri, well into, just shortly before they came in and conquered it all. So his name was widespread. He brought unity to the north. So very much like Solomon had brought unity to all of Israel, Omri brings unity to the north. Omri was probably a very good negotiator and a good diplomat with the countries around him, because they seemed to have peace, at least with Assyria, because in the same time frame, Assyria is coming across, if you're familiar with what the Crescent Valley is, it would be the upper reaches of Iraq, Iran, and then on into not quite to Damascus, but Syria, on into that area. And the Assyrians have been coming and conquering west. And at the same time all this is going on, and they're a big, powerful, nasty army, the same time this is going on, Omri is conquering the Transjordan, both north and, I don't remember how far south, but a big chunk of land that he conquers. And all of this is in extra-biblical literature, and is only important in order for us to be able to contrast what the writer of Kings is trying to get across to us. None of that mattered to him. None of that was important in the biblical narrative. He didn't care that Omri was a good negotiator, and we're going to see Ahab learned a lot of things from his dad, because he marries into the Sidonian kingdom, takes Jezebel as his wife, and she's a foreigner and a Baal worshiper, just a blatant idolater, more so than than Israel has seen, and draws her husband Ahab into that same place. But where we're at right now with Omri, I didn't tell you the title of the message, but it's just a downward spiral, because everything that's been going on since Solomon and through the kings that we're reading about here is just this continual downward spiral. You've all, I'm sure, heard the phrase that the definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting different results, right? Well, all of these kings in the north continued to use their own might and their own strength and their own ideas to take over the kingdom. And then they would just fall right back in and do the same thing that Jeroboam did and expect something different to happen. Not understanding that Yahweh was in charge? I don't know. I don't know how they couldn't have known that Yahweh was the God there, but well, the only God. But they didn't seem to grasp that, mostly because they didn't trust him, and they didn't do the things that Deuteronomy called them to do. They didn't have the book. The king didn't write down these laws and remember them and use them to run the kingdom. So they did what was right in their own eyes, essentially, and did what would keep them in power. So now Ahab, verse 29, in the 38th year of Asa, king of Judah, Ahab the son of Omri began to reign over Israel. And Ahab the son of Omri reigned over Israel and Samaria 22 years. Other thing that happened in Samaria, I was talking about how Omri was similar to Solomon, that he brought peace to the north, kind of reunited them after they'd been split between Timni and Omri. He also, when he moved to Samaria, there was already probably a small village there, but he fortified it, and that's where he built a temple. And this would have been a counterfeit temple, but it was a center place of worship, just like they had in Jerusalem. So again, this was the idea of this counterfeit worship happening in the north in this counterfeit kingdom. Verse 30. And Ahab, the son of Omri, did evil in the sight of the Lord, more than all who were before him. So it's just continuing to spiral. It keeps getting better. They keep digging the hole deeper. And as if it had been a light thing for him to walk in the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, he took for his wife Jezebel, the daughter of Ethbaal, king of the Sidonians, and went and served Baal and worshipped him. So here we've got a king of Israel worshiping Baal. This is like the worst that could happen. And drawn away. Just like Deuteronomy said, drawn away because of not many wives in his case, but just for marrying someone who is just an idolatrous pagan. And from a worldly perspective, this union was probably wise because Sidonia was Tyre and Sidon. Major trade route, major shipping port, powerful place. You remember all the trees of Lebanon that Solomon got came from Tyre. So not an unwealthy place and had influence. And so from a worldly perspective, this was probably a good marriage. Gave him a buffer on the western border. But from a godly perspective, from a biblical perspective, it was a terrible choice. So he erects an altar, verse 32, he erected an altar for Baal in the house of Baal, which he built in Samaria. And Ahab made an Asherah. Ahab did more to provoke the Lord, the God of Israel, to anger than all the kings of Israel who were before him. That's quite an accomplishment. In his days, Hiel of Bethel built Jericho. He laid its foundation at the cost of Abiram, his firstborn, and set up its gates at the cost of his youngest son, Segub, according to the word of the Lord, which he spoke by Joshua, the son of Nun. This is just an odd little chunk inserted here at the end. It seems that this is probably just showing how complete the reversal is. Jericho, you remember, is the first place when Joshua, when they enter into the promised land, and Jericho's the first city on the west side of the Jordan that falls. They march around it for 7 days and blow the horn, doing everything, trusting God, doing exactly what he told them to do, and all the walls come down. And if you remember, In fact, let's just turn there. Joshua chapter 6. Joshua is back to the left also, just before Judges, the other side of 1 2 Samuel, right after Deuteronomy. So Israel, at this point in Joshua, has entered the Promised Land. They've taken Jericho. So they've begun this conquest that God is sending them on into the Promised Land. And after they've taken Jericho, Joshua, chapter 6, verse 26. Joshua laid an oath on them at that time, saying, "Cursed before the Lord be the man who rises up and rebuilds the city Jericho. At the cost of his firstborn shall he lay its foundation, and at the cost of his youngest son shall he set up its gates." Don't know for sure exactly what is going on here, but with this, it could be that from his first to his last, that he's going to lose all of his children is going to be the cost. Anybody who rebuilds the city, the cost is going to be all of his children. There's some commentators who say that Hiel back in Kings, when he does this, that whether the child was stillborn or they sacrificed, killed the child somehow, anyway, into a jar, into a clay pot, and then buried in the foundation as an offering for this. And then the same thing with his youngest son at the when they put the gates, when they opened the gates back up or rebuilt the gates of the city, that there would have been a sacrifice at the beginning and a sacrifice at the end. So whether God took these children or whether Hiel sacrificed them because of some pagan worship, we don't know. There's people on both sides of it, smart people that say both things. But the fact is that the word of the Lord came true, irregardless of how it came about, irregardless of how it happened. And that indeed, at the cost of his firstborn, the foundation was laid, and at the cost of his youngest son, the gates were set up. And what this symbolizes is this complete reversal of what Joshua and the people of the children of Israel had gone in and taken the land. And at least in the north now, we've seen a complete reversal of that, and Baal worship has taken over. Essentially, it's returned to Canaan in every way possible, including the rebuilding of Jericho. So that's pretty dark days in Israel. Now, at this point, the text is going to slow down considerably. We're gonna meet Elijah, and just a lot of the famous stories that happened there. That we're gonna see just how bad Ahab is and Jezebel, and we'll start into all that next week when we jump into chapter 17. So as we're wrapping up a little bit here, a few things to talk about. I talked a little bit about compatibilism last week, and I said we were going to see more of it this week. This compatibilism is this idea that we have free will, right? We can make decisions. God holds us morally accountable for them. And there's nothing that we can do or decide to do that thwarts his sovereignty. His sovereignty trumps our free will. Even though he allows us to have free will, he certainly allows us to make decisions and for things to happen. He's not deterministic. He doesn't. We're not like puppets. We're not. He doesn't. He guides our path for sure, but he doesn't force us to go a particular place or way or to make particular decisions, right? But because he's sovereign, because he's God, he's able to take, which is amazing, because it's like every one of us here makes free will decisions every day, right? And he's able to weave all those together and blend them and still have his purposes as the outcome. And where we saw that again tonight is in the story of Baasha. Because God didn't let him off the hook. He was the instrument that God used to carry out his plan, to carry out his judgment against Jeroboam and his family. But I said earlier that his, well, and then he was judged accordingly. It said in the text there that because he destroyed the house of Jeroboam, that his house also came under the same judgment. And I made the statement then that it was because of his motivation. It was because of his heart. And his motivation was more important than what he did. And I say that because, well, for instance, had he, like Asa, the last king that we started with right there at the end of chapter 15, who we talked about last week, if he had done like Asa did, or if he was like Josiah, who we'll read about later, who went in and tore down the high places, tore down the Asherah poles, if he would have returned to Israel to Yahweh worship, to real Yahweh worship, then that would have been a righteous judgment that Baasha brought against the house of Jeroboam. But he didn't do that. He didn't do that because he loved God. He did that because he wanted to be king. He did that for his own selfish motivations. So God judged his actions just like he had Jeroboam's. And, I mean, further than that, it tells us that that Baasha walked in the same sins, the same idolatry that Jeroboam had. So he wasn't trying to reestablish Yahweh worship, which would have made his actions righteous. However, God still used his evil actions to carry out his plan. Modern example, okay? And this isn't about a particular person, but just modern events that are happening. I had a meeting Monday with a couple of guys that they're reps for Mission India, which is an organization that ministers, takes the gospel to people, trains up people in India, and just getting a little bit of insight on what's going on there, talking to them about, you know, we've seen on the news, or, you know, we saw a while back on the news where they're burning people in parking lots, parks, the street, wherever they can find room, because there was so much death going on, so many people dying, and COVID related. I mean, people really were dying from COVID there. If you look at the numbers that are available online, they're like the second highest reporting numbers, at least. It's over 400,000. These guys were saying that the reports that they're hearing from their friends on the ground, that it's probably 10 times that. So in the neighborhood of 4 million people in India that have died from COVID. And the reason it doesn't get reported that way is most of the time, if somebody dies in India, they don't take them to the morgue. They don't take them to get a death certificate. They take them out and they put them on a pyre, a pile of wood, and light it on fire, because that's how they take care of their dead, with the idea of reincarnation. You know, they're hoping, their only hope in Hinduism is reincarnation, that they'll come back as something better than what they were here as this time. Maybe just to put a few of our own challenges and issues with all of this into perspective, they also shared that 60 pastors in one state alone had died from COVID. They said that everyone that they know in India has experienced, also all the people that work with Mission India that they know and have been in contact with have experienced some kind of loss because of COVID. So just this amazing evil thing, no matter what you think about any of the other things going on with masks or vaccines or where it came from or how this has all happened, doesn't matter. The fact is that there's a disease that has killed at least 400 and some odd thousand people in India, probably, you know, many more than that, maybe 10 times as many. And yet, the relief efforts that these guys are involved in are opening avenues for people to hear the gospel, which is amazing to see. I mean, serious grief going on and serious pain happening there, and yet God is using it to bring people into the kingdom. God is using that, using what someone, whoever, the enemy, whoever, something that was meant for evil, you know, whether this is, I'm not saying it was on purpose or anything else, okay, so don't read into this more than I'm saying, but whatever the cause of this, it was meant to bring evil and havoc and disunity to the world. And yet God is using it to bring about good, to bring people into the kingdom. because there are people there bringing relief, being a friend, being a shoulder to cry on, bringing food, bringing water. Most people in India live day to day. I mean, they work today so they can eat tomorrow. They don't have refrigerators and freezers and pantries full of food. And two quotes here. One, just this idea of how relief opens doors. Nobody cares how much you know or what you know until they know how much you care. Teddy Roosevelt said that, among probably many others as well. But, and then the second quote is, by this all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another, Jesus of Nazareth. Israel needed a different king. They needed to put the shovel down, shovel, and stop digging. If you find yourself in a hole, put the shovel down. Don't keep digging, okay? You're not going to get out by digging further down. We just simply need to look around our world, look around our country. Things aren't really so different today than they were for Israel. We need a king, like the one described in Deuteronomy. Remember, I'll just read through it again. It said, and when he sits on the throne of his kingdom, he shall write for himself in a book, a copy of this law, approved by the Levitical priests. Maybe we need a king who actually wrote the law. And it shall be with him, and he shall read it all the days of his life, that he may learn to fear the Lord his God by keeping all the words of this law and these statutes and doing them, that his heart may not be lifted up above his brothers, and that he may not turn aside from the commandment, either to the right hand or to the left, so that he may continue long in his kingdom, he and his children in Israel. That's the kind of king Israel needed. That's the kind of king we need. We need a king that takes away sin rather than causing us to sin. We need a king that leads us away from temptation rather than leading us into temptation or leading us into evil. We need a king that does what's right in the eyes of the Lord, the eyes of Yahweh. Someone about whom the Father might say, this is my son, in him I am well pleased. Who can lead us to the place of the Father, who also can lead us to the place of the Father saying of us, well done, good and faithful servant? Thankfully, we have a king exactly like that in Jesus. It is a beautiful thing. I mentioned earlier that just like the Israelites, we are still called into obedience, an obedience of the heart that's expressed through outward action. What must we do? The people, right after being fed, asked Jesus, what must we do to be doing the works of God? And Jesus answered them, this is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he sent. Believe in me. Believe in Jesus, he's saying. Believe in me. Jesus is saying this. Believe in Jesus the Messiah. He is our king. He is the king our world so desperately needs. And as you are believing, point others to him. Quick story, or just to think about this story. Remember Moses and the serpent? Moses and the serpents, the serpent he puts on the staff. Just a brief point in pointing others toward Jesus. Because if you're anything like me, you have a tendency to want to tear things down and to argue people into the kingdom. That never happens. You don't argue people into the kingdom. Or tear down their belief system sometimes. Punch holes in their belief system. This is not very effective either. If you remember the story during the Exodus, they're out wandering in the wilderness, and because of their disobedience, God sends these snakes, and people are getting bit, and people are dying. And he tells Moses, hey, put this iron serpent, or this brass serpent, on the end of this pole and hold it up. And people are going to look at it, and they're going to be healed. Well, the serpent isn't healing them. Their faith isn't really healing them, although it's because they are willing to trust and to believe that by looking at this, I'm going to be saved or I'm going to be healed, that it starts to happen. And so people look there. Jesus used this example, and he said, and when I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw all people to myself.
So, and this is where I'm getting that idea to not tear down other belief systems, but rather lift up the name of Jesus, exalt Jesus before other people. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Lord, we're grateful for your word, grateful for even bad examples that we get in your word, Lord, because it gives us a contrast and it gives us an idea of who you really are and an idea of the king we need, the king you want us to have, the king you provided for us, and that's amazing. Thank you, Father, for providing Jesus as our king. It's the hymn that we look to in our times of grief, our times of stress, our times of need, Lord, and we are grateful that you are faithful and just to deliver on your promises. Thankfully, you don't give us everything we always want, Lord, but you do give us what we need, and most of all, you give us salvation. You give us the opportunity, a way to come into your presence, to be reconciled to you. That is truly amazing, Lord. We thank you for this, Lord, and I pray, Father, that you just bless each and every person that's here this evening, and as they go home and consider these things, Lord, that if there is anyone here or anyone watching on the internet that doesn't know you, that you would make, even as we sang earlier, make your presence known, Lord, in a deeper way. They would know your goodness. We love you and thank you so much in Jesus' name. Amen.